Hello, RPG Chick here, and welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. Blind? Well, we're going to go to...
Why not
go to the Necropolis? We have to hit this light one over... Where's the light one? Oh, the light one's up here.
Yes.
We need a fast-forward feature. These guys are hacking off bits of that body. I don't think they killed that person.
Yes, now.
So bossy. So that brings us here. And then we want to go... We want to go to action. So I'm having a great time with this game still. Loving it. Out of all the games I'm playing right now, it's really the one I most look forward to playing, so... yeah, Necropolis, and I've got scripts written down. I have 1, 5, 3, and 5, which is some kind of note there. Oh, that's the note that what's-his-name Phoenix wants us to find. 3, 5, 4, and 3... A symbol or instrument. Something about Calistage and Chiquette? I'm not sure. My notes are like running together here. There's so many of them. And then 3431 is to the code to Mila Vest. And 4221... Oh, is that girl Choi. Something about that girl Choi who was killed or sacrificed or something like that. Ooh. So something tells me this is not going to be a typical undead experience. Well, hello. Motley. Stunted and piebald with a large hairless head, this humanoid reminds you of a court jester, except that his wide violet eyes sparkle with cunning and intelligence, giving the impression that there is much going on inside his large dome.
Well, you. You can't be here. Why did you come?
Several people sit bound and beaten along the far wall, surrounded by corpses. At second glance, some of those bound may themselves be dead as well. The man steps closer, lowering his voice to a growl.
Well, answer me.
Never mind, I'll leave. What's going on here? Either way, we don't have an option to tell him to actually answer him, which is funny. He looks around, comprehension dawning on his face as he takes in the room and its contents.
It's not what you think.
His mouth widens in an ugly smile.
We were just defending ourselves, trying to reclaim what small part of this world fate has seen fit to cede us. It never would have to come to this if we only had someone to help us explain.
Making a note.
He gestures to the open corridor.
We are worshippers, you see. There's a terminal down there that provides access to the tombs, but this memorialist,
he spits at the woman behind him,
has placed a whisper lock on it. Without the code, we cannot enter the tombs and join our lord and interfere in worship. She's rather narrow-sighted, doesn't see the value in what we do. If we regain our access to the gate, we can show her firsthand.
He smiles. The effect is not reassuring. He thinks it would be better to release them in Lord Innifer's presence, but any end is justified. There must be some way we can solve this peaceably.
The time for peaceable solutions is over. The gate awaits. We must answer its call at any cost.
He thinks their lives are forfeit whether we have the code or not, but we must have it. If you kill them all, how will you get the code then? You'd be lost forever. Blue Tide.
And if we don't follow through on our threats? No. They must know that we will kill them, code or not. If they all die, we will find another way.
His mouth turns in a frightening grin.
She wouldn't have locked the terminal from her fellow memorialists. One of them will know something.
persuasion. I do have, I am trained in persuasion. Just let me talk to them. It won't cost you anything to try. 90%. Success. He considers your words for a long moment, then...
You may be right. All right, you have my permission to speak to the prisoners. If you can get the code from them, we can end this charade. Terry and more will die each day until either you or they give us what we need.
He turns to the woman bound on the floor.
The code is all we want, after all. The rest of this does not become any of us.
Ooh, I like the theme. These rocks appear to have been brought in from the outside and welded into place somehow, sealing this entrance. Interesting how they suddenly move like that. This material is springy to the touch, but impossible to damage. You can make out only diffused shadows beyond it. Alright. Talk to Motley a little bit more first? I don't know. The piebald man watches you approach, a sour smile pulling at the edges of his lips.
You're back. I don't suppose you've learned anything?
Did someone named Kiyotawa come through here?
The Dendra child, yes.
His mouth curls in a slight sneer.
She came to the valley some time ago.
She went down to see if Lord Interfere... She went down to see Lord Interfere before the memorialist locked us out.
She's probably still down there. If you wish to see her, find the code.
I don't know the code. I'll keep looking.
Why are you wasting my time?
Let's go.
This corpse is curled pitifully on its side, as if anticipating another kick to the ribs. Their eyes are opened in horror at whatever happened to them. Oh, it's using they because we don't know the gender. Whoever this person was in life, they are unrecognizable now. The combination of starvation, beatings, and torture has rendered all but their eyes unreadable. There's an indentation on the middle finger of their right hand that might have once borne a ring, but that too is gone. Go through the pockets. You find nothing but a lovingly folded scrap of paper with the number 4135 and the name Najma. Okay, writing this down because I don't think all of these codes are showing up or will show up in the journal. From corpse. Four, one, three, five. What if I tell them the wrong code? Gold tied. With two careful fingers, you pull his eyelids closed and shut his horrified mouth.
What?
Thank you, Talira says. Her gaze lingers on the corpse, but the gratitude in her voice was heartfelt.
They keep looking through the pockets again.
Surprised we only get, like, blue tide or something for that. Talira, Butwag, Narv the Blessed, Jenkins, the Jinxed, Leroy Jenkins, Jalen the Math. Let's talk to this gate cultist. Probably doesn't have anything to say. You're blocking my light. Yeah, fascinating. Let's talk to Talira. She just thanked us. This middle-aged woman sits stoically, her hands bound in front of her legs. The sleeves of her robe have fallen from her wrists, and you catch sight of yellow and purple bruising above the lacerations of her tightly cinched bonds. Streams of tears have carved channels down her dust-covered face. She looks up at you, her eyes the color of the seas around Sagas. Two more tears slip silently down her cheeks. She turns away from you. She thinks, has she come to save us? To end these pointless deaths? No, probably not. Who are you? She does not answer. Instead, she turns away, tears dripping from her chin. Why are you crying? That's a stupid question. She shakes her head almost imperceptibly, but says nothing. Do you know the passcode to the Whisperlock?
Making a note.
Finally, she looks up at you and speaks, her voice hoarse, as though she has been shouting for days.
You're one of them. I will not speak to you, nor give you the passcode.
She thinks even the clue, the name of the Citril Prince, is too much to give her.
Ooh.
I need more post-its here. I used to use them as notepads. Okay. Code to the gate. I know it's probably added to my journal, too, but... So it would be right in front of my face at all. Was it Guri or something like that? Citril Prince. Because I've heard this name. It's just I played this yesterday. If I had continued on from yesterday, I'd probably remember. Oh, Guni! Guni Goo Goo! There it is. Is the passcode Guni by any chance? Her face becomes the color of ash. Her mouth opens and closes in a wordless stammer. It takes a moment for her to collect herself. No, she says finally. Of course not. That's ridiculous. But her voice is shaking and her eyes plead with you not to tell. Yeah. I'll kill her. No. Oomph. She looks up at you, her tears continuing their ceaseless fall. Then she turns away. Okay, Utwag. This short, red-haired man has vivid green eyes that emanate a mix of sadness, lost dreams, and hope. The stranger sizes you up, and for a second you feel true interest in your persona. But then he looks away, lost in his thoughts. A moment later, he turns back and smiles. This smile is like his eyes, full of shards of emotions, caution, cynicism, fear, and friendliness. His arms are tied, and he looks like he's been beat up pretty badly. I'm Utwag, by the way. Utwag Los, and leader of these sad sacks. Wish we could meet under better circumstances. Can you tell me about yourself? He straightens, though it's clear the effort pains him. I'm an explorer and do-gooder, self-proclaimed. For some reason, he smirks at the stout man next to him when he says this. I've been all over the world, had every occupation and hardship you could imagine. Why, I even had my luck stolen from me. And do you know what I learned in all of that? He leans forward. You can do anything if you work for it. Anything. Luckless master of hard work. How did you get here? He leans forward conspiratorially. Let me tell you. We left the Oasis some weeks ago, tracking a tale of deceit and fabled Numenera. We were hired to find something called a world string, a tiny contraption that can spin a web so fine it's all but invisible, but so strong it could slice the world in two, if someone had the means and the mind for it. No idea if it actually exists, but that's how this all started. World string. So fine it's invisible and can slice the world in two. Well, there we were, out in the Vexulian wastes, when we happened across a broken hound the size of a Griffalo. Something had irritated it, so we decided to seek shelter and wait for nightfall, to see if it might not range a little further from the route we wanted to take. I was looking for just such a place when something slammed into me and knocked me down into this valley. He thinks it was Narv trying to kill me again. I don't blame him, though. It's all for the best. Well, Narv is one of these people. Narv and Jenkins followed, of course, and we ran into these fine memorialists in a bit of trouble. Now, I'm never one to turn down a challenge or a people in need. It's almost a curse, you might say. So, of course, we agree to help them lock their necropolis. After that, well, you can see what happened after that. We were searching for something called the World String when we literally stumbled into this valley. Our own quest has been put on hold when we help these fine people. Who are your companions? He tilts his head toward the rat-like man near him. That's Narv the Blessed. Meanest bastard this world has seen, except that he keeps messing it up somehow. Narv says, "That's the brush you're painting me with? Bah!" He scowls and turns away. Utwag gestures with his head to the earnest-looking man with a smile. And that's Jenkins, the Jinxed. Always around to help, especially when you don't need it. Jenkins says, "Did you say you needed help, boss?" Utwag laughs. "No, friend. Or at least there's nothing you don't already know about." Jenkins the Jinxed and Narv the Blessed. Finest explorers you'll ever meet. Don't forget about us, right? Alright, Narv the Blessed, or Blessed. This stout fellow has a cruel scowl and beady eyes. He is unkempt and dressed in clothes that don't quite fit. In a low, gruff voice, he seems to be muttering to himself about some plot or other going wrong. His hands are bound and constantly working at the cords as if they have a life of their own. Name's Narv. Narv the Blessed, if you can believe that. Which I can't. You tell me about yourself? I'm an explorer and a villain. The worst villain you'll ever meet. And by that I mean that no matter what I try to pull, it somehow ends up helping people. He spits. Blessed indeed. You come across another Narv, you stick him a good one for me, alright? How did you get here? He leans forward and talks to you in low tones. It was all Utwag's fault. God's damn do-gooder can't help himself. We're on a quest, he calls it, for this fabled string or whatever. I figure it's my chance to off him once and for all. We come across this enormous broken hound, so I tossed a few rocks at it to get its attention. Well, Utwag wouldn't fight it or run, no. He calmed it down and left it alone. So I tried a second time, shoving Utwag down a mountainside when we got too close. As luck would have it, I lost my balance and fell down with him. Of course, idiot Jenkins follows us to help. He puffs out a blast of air. That's how we got to this valley. When these memorialists asked for our help, we all saw an opportunity. Jenkins to help, Utwag to grow in his path or whatever, and me to finally do Utwag in. He shakes his head sadly. Then those cultists caught us before I could try anything. I tell you, nothing ever goes my way. Just another frayed end of the string that is my blessed failures. Who are your companions? The red-headed fellow, he's Utwag Los. In a hushed tone, he adds, I've been trying to kill him for about 12 years now. He leans back and indicates the smooth-faced man. And the young pup here is Jenkins the Jinxed. He'll want to help you. Don't let him. He leers at the young man, who smiles back at him as if he just said the nicest thing. The red-headed one's Utwag and the dumb-looking one's Jenkins. Don't ask me why I'm still with them. I haven't figured it out yet. Good riddance. Jenkins. Hello. This young man smiles up at you shyly, his left eye sealed shut by a combination of crime and blood. The rest of his body hasn't fared much better, and the cords around his wrists and ankles have rubbed his flesh raw. He sees you staring and shakes his head, so hair falls over his ruined eye. Can I help you? He asks politely. So I'm trying to figure out if this is a nod to, Jenkins? You know? Charge in Jenkins, or Jenkins from Mass Effect, or both. You're bound and bruised, and you ask if I need help? Ah, he looks at the cords that bind him, testing them experimentally. I mean, I know you're probably right, but couldn't you need help anyway? He looks up at you hopefully. Maybe just a little bit of help? Actually, I do need to know the passcode for the Whisperlock. His face brightens, and he nods at you enthusiastically. Excellent! As soon as I learn what it is, I will tell you. He catches your expression. A sad look comes on his face. Oh, you hoped I knew it already. Sorry, friend. He gives you a sudden broad smile. But if you need anything else, you know exactly where I'll be. He holds his bound hands toward you. Here. I'll be here. Just so we understand each other. Eritus says, I think you and I are going to get along splendidly. Eritus thinks, he would have made a splendid hero, perhaps he already is. Jenkins seems momentarily taken aback and ducks his head shyly. You're the first person ever to say that to me, he says, sniffling and wiping at his eyes. Eritus leans down and clasps him on the shoulder, and the two of them bask silently in mutual affection. Okay. Who are you? I'm Jenkins. Jenkins the Jinxed. He winkles his nose. It wasn't my first choice of name, believe me, but I don't really mind it anymore. It's kind of apt. He looks you over, then shuffles forward a little, leaning closer. You see, I really like to help people, but I have a habit of getting lost. He says in what he clearly thinks is a whisper, I'll camp down for the night with my party, and by morning they'll all be gone. He stares up at you in wide-eyed wonderment. It's a terrible curse, really it is. He kicks at the floor and sighs. Utweg and Narv are the only people I never lost, he says morosely. Not for lack of trying, says Narv. Don't worry, Narv, I'll never try to lose you. Jenkins the Jinxed, helper of, well, everyone. How did you get here? Well, we came across the Wastes, he says pensively. The Vexulian Wastes, of course, not the Tempest Wastes. He laughs lightly, as if at his own joke. Then Narv pushed Utweg down a sand dune, and he tumbled into this gravestone valley. Almost broke his neck. I'm glad he didn't, though. I still don't know why he pushed him. Maybe it was an accident. Then, he pauses, searching his memory, we ran into these memorialists who asked for our help. They wanted to lock the necropolis from these cultists. Of course I said yes, but well, we weren't so lucky. But at least we kept them out. He shrugs and rolls his eyes in the universal gesture for, what can you do? Who are your companions? The red-haired one is Utweg Los, our leader. He's been all over the world, you know. He's famous. Jenkins gives you a nod, his face serious, as if trying to impress upon you the gravity of the situation. The other fellow is Narv. He tries to hurt people, but it never turns out right. What? Narv's eyes widen and he looks around worriedly. I don't hurt people. Jenkins smiles and leans in toward you. I like him. He thinks, heh, he thought I hadn't noticed. How stupid does he think I am? Utweg Los and Narv the Blast, I'm sure I speak for all of us when I say we're at your service. See you soon. Huh. I like this theme. Jalen. This alluring woman looks up, white hair brushing her shoulders. She allows a slight smile to pull at the corners of her mouth. Her face is confusing, for though her skin has the tightness of youth, her eyes pierce you with the wisdom of 100 years. She rests her hand on the daggers at her hips, perhaps waiting to see if you have the courage to make the first move. You know, it would be cool if at least some of these characters, like when we see them, their portrait shows up here. So you better look at how they really look. Who are you? Jalen of Underhouse Demath, she says, then blinks. Sorry, habit. Demath has gone into the dark like all the others. I'm just Jalen these days. She thinks, now what brought that on? You mentioned an underhouse. What's that? I can't believe I told you my full name, she says with a rueful chuckle. My croft father would have had me whipped. Her hands close over her daggers. I come from a world beside this one, from a city in the Hollow Core, ruled by 16 underhouses built into the walls. Then, she frowns, counting silently, a few decades back I woke to screams, and not one or two, not like you get from the lower city from time to time, but hundreds. She grins, but there is uneasiness in it. And she thinks, I'm getting soft. That's the only explanation. Drink. I found out that the shadows are pouring from the walls of the world, the underhouses. The people inside were just melting into it, screaming. Staring past you, she continues, a few of us made it out through a portal into the bloom. The shadows wouldn't follow. I think the bloom scared even them. She grins. At any rate, I made a living for a while plying the family trade, but there was no joy in it. Not until I found the Endless Gate, and they gave me a reason to work. Hmm. Tell me about your family trade. She barks a laugh, hitting her forehead with the heel of her hand. Where is my head today? I'm a... what's the word you use here? Torturer. I get information through pain. Well, lovely. Underhouse DeMath was famous for it, and I was the only one of my family left. I thought I'd make them proud by following in the trade here. She shakes her head, sighing at her own naivete. Nearly starved, my first year in the bloom, barely anyone wanted to hire me, and those that did paid pittances for my family's holy work and treating me like some kind of monster. She pinches the bridge of her nose. I drank a lot in those days, talking about my family and how they served the people they killed, freed them from their secrets, right? And one night I said all this to a member of the Endless Gate. She chuckles. Such luck! They said I belong with them. They were right. I torture people to free them from their secrets. The Endless Gate and I are a good match. Talking about the death of your world doesn't seem to pain you all that much. Well, it was foretold, she says with a careless shrug. Underhouse DeShando, that was the prophet caste, was wrong about the date, is all. Shame that all of us suffered because they were sloppy, but they're either dead now or still getting eaten. In other words, I knew it was coming my whole life. Wasn't expecting to live through it, so getting weepy about the whole thing would be a slap in the face to everyone I left behind. What a remarkable perspective, Calistus murmurs. Would that more people could act this way. After all, the one great truth in life is that we know it will come to an end one day. What use is it to fuss and bother? Jaylin bows slightly. As I said, why insult the dead by declaring that you were afraid to be among their number? You wouldn't be thinking of pulling those daggers on me, would you? I'd prefer not to, she says, palms of her hands flat on the rounded pommels of her twin weapons. You seem pleasant enough. I suppose we'll see how things go, won't we? Any suggestions on how to get information out of the memorialist? Yeah, pain. Well, you'd think violence would work, but that's a dead end. She breathes an irritated sigh. I think she's one of those altruists. You know, the ones who will stand up to days of torture, but spill any secret if it'll help those who hear it. She spreads her hands with a roll of her eyes. You notice a streak of blood along the edge of her thumb. Obviously, she knows we don't mean her well, but maybe you can convince her you do. Hmm. Seek the truth, stranger.
Without doubt.
Alright, thought I might have been missing somebody here. So we can only talk to this lady then, Talira. But do we even want to give him the code? Let's lie. The passcode is Najma. Idiot! His face turns bright red. Did you think we wouldn't have searched every corpse we created? Did you think we wouldn't have tried every word we can find? You didn't test it yourself, did you? Just thought to yourself, oh, how clever I am for finding a note those idiot children could not find. He spits on your feet. Try harder, or your corpse will join his. Oh. Alright, so we want to go try it then?
Don't mind.
Oh, we're free to just go this way then? Abandoned bowls, rotted fruit, incense, and other oddities fill the corridor. Tokens brought to honor the dead. Loot!
I'm going.
I love loot. 28 shins.
Of course.
More loot. Thank God for the tab key. Ooh, what's this? A Kandiru. Oh. Kandiru. That's the name of a... You know, I think it's the name of a metal band, I believe. And I think they named it after some creature from, like, Dungeons and Dragons or something. Kandiru? I'm not sure. I'll have to look it up after this. Bonded item artifact. +4 damage. +1 damage per effort applied. Max +8 on unarmed attacks. Unfortunately, negative effects. -1 training level in endurance and healing skills. When placed against the wrist, this wriggling eel burrows beneath the skin and releases a powerful agent that strengthens the muscles used in hand-to-hand combat. Alright, well, I'm going to put that away, because I don't partake in hand-to-hand combat.
I'm going.
25 shins? Nice, there's a lot of loot around here. Did I look near the bowl? Here.
Yes.
33 shins and a heavenly submission. This otherworldly gem is like anything you've seen before, with cuts so fine that they are beyond counting. Let's take a look at this stuff. I don't know. Alright, so that we can discard or equip. Can't seem to do anything with that. Thousands of names scroll across the surface of this sphere. There's no indication of how they died, assuming that's what the names mean.
I'm going.
Nice. All this money. 34 more shins. This jar is filled with ashes. More ashes than one human body could produce. This jar is warm to the touch and vibrating slightly.
Yes, now.
A susurrus of voices whisper
in this world, then.
Oh, not trying to talk to her.
Why not?
A susurrus of voices whispers from this jar every so often.
Let's go.
Is that the gate? These lights, bending and refracting in upon themselves, must have been brought to honor someone important. The names have been worn away by time, however. An enormous cavern yawns beyond the platform. A seemingly infinite number of honeycombed rooms stretch out past where you can see.
On it.
A shimmering field obscures this pedestal. It seems to be emanating from a small device within the field. That must be the Whisperlock. Also inside is a configuration of buttons surrounding a central dial, but with the Whisperlock engaged, there is no way to reach them. I'm not going to use it. Memorialist, let's just see. Nothing happens. Well, eventually we get it. I know it's Goonie. At least, pretty sure. So what about these people, though? If we go through there,
without doubt,
I'm afraid they're going to kill those people.
Of course.
I'm afraid I might fight you now. Yeah, it worked. What you're doing is wrong. It ends now. As you will it, the pudgy man snarls. He backs away, calling to his comrades. Oh, these two, right? Children, to me! We must protect Lord Interfere.